to part two of the Peter Widd story, and now it gets really, really interesting. When he was on Brian Clough's radar, it took him a couple of weeks to agree to sign to Nottingham Forest, but the rest is very much history. There, this tension between the player and the manager. He doesn't like me, I don't know where I stand with him, and yet he instilled that confidence. There is one parallel, isn't there, between you and Martin, in that you were both sold on at the pinnacle of your careers at Nottingham Forest. He went to Norwich, I think, from memory. You went to second division Newcastle. From the outside, I never understood how someone who'd won the championship, being one of the main goal scorers, could sign for what was then a second division club for quite a low amount of money in those days, £225,000. It sounds like, well, it's Wayne Rooney's weekly wage now. But £225,000, even in the late 70s, early 80s, when players like Andy Gray or Trevor Francis were going for £1 million or £1.5 million, was very cheap. Just give us an idea of why he sold you to Newcastle and why the transfer fee was so low.
We had a, I'd signed a two-year contract with a year option on the contract, and everyone was getting, because we'd won the championship, everyone was getting pay rises. So it was only fitting that I went in to speak to him about a pay rise. So he said, as he always does, what do you think you're worth? So I told him what I was worth. And he come back and he said, no, I don't think, I think you, I asked for £180 a week in them days.
Was that after tax?
Yeah. It's funny because of the year we won the championship, so we won the League Cup, won the championship, quarter final of the FA Cup, and my P45 at the end of that year was £9,990. That was all your bonuses, signing on fees, salary. You know, and people say, no, that can't be right. I'm saying, I'm telling you, that's what it was. Anyway, I was negotiating and asked for 180, and he said, right, I'll have a think about it and I'll come back to you. And then when I found out that Robbo, Viv Anderson, Woody, John McGovern, they all got £200 a week. So I thought, I shot myself in the foot here.
Yes.
I said, but that's the way you are. Well, we didn't have agents in them days.
No.
So the argument was, he offered me 170, I asked for 180. He wouldn't compromise. Then he said to me, he asked me to put in a transfer request. So I said to them, well, it's not going to resolve this, is it? So I ended up putting in a transfer request, and he just said to me, right, you can go, I'll sell you. So I said, that's fine. Because he actually thought he had a ready-made replacement in a fella called Steve Elliott, who was scoring goals in the reserves. Anyway, cut a long story short, I left over £10, but there was a lot of clubs that were in for me, but he wouldn't sell me to a first division team. So I knew, I found out later that Ron Atkinson, who was at West Brom, was trying to buy me. And there was a couple of other managers who were trying to buy me. Teddy Venables was trying to buy me. And he didn't want to sell me to a Premier League team for the simple reason as, first division at the time. He didn't want me to come back and then bite him on the backside.
Talk about player power, TV rights, all those things which have changed, agents, and you're on £9,990 with your bonuses at the best team in England, which had beaten off Liverpool for all those trophies, the championship. So you're at Newcastle for a short time in the second division. They were a successful high-end second division side, as you'd expect of Newcastle. But then the bit I want to talk most about, and I'm sure most Aston Villa fans want to talk about, was the summer when Ron Saunders paid £500,000 to bring you back into the first division with Villa, and the start of the most remarkable season that Aston Villa have had in 71 years and 35, 40 years since. An amazing season, 14 players used, and a remarkable championship, and then the European Cup. Did you expect Or did you think, was it a target to someone who'd already won the league championship that you could win it again with Aston Villa?
Well, it's funny because when I left, Bill McGarry was my manager who saw me, and all of a sudden he's the manager at Newcastle United, so he knew what he was going to get. And he came in to buy me. But I'd said to, he wanted me to sign a four-year contract. And I said to him, Bill, I'm not being funny. I says, you're in the second division. I'm coming out of the first division. I'll give you 2 years. I says, I won't give you one. I'll give you 2 years. If you can get us into the first division, all well and good. I'd won trophies, and I want to win trophies again. So if we're not going to do it at Newcastle, after 2 years, that'll give me a reflection of what's going to happen at the football club. And of course, we didn't get up in the 2 years, and my contract was up. And it wasn't then that you were sort of free agent.
Bosman.
You were under Bosman ruling, but yet someone had to pay a fee for you. And at the time, you could go to arbitration and appeal how much you wanted to pay. I had a dream many, many years ago that I played for Aston Villa Football Club. And people used to say to me, what do you mean? So I said, I remember having this dream playing for Aston Villa Football Club. And of course, when I went to America and Vic Crowe was the manager, I thought that broke my dream because he was the manager of Aston Villa when I had the dream. And I thought that was it, really. So when I went to speak with Ron Saunders, and I had four clubs at the time all vying for my signature, and one of them was my hometown club, Everton. So
that must have been very appealing because they were a very good side then too.
Well, Everton have always been this sort of club that's, when I watch them, the likes of the Golden Vision, Alec Young and all these players, like I was speaking about Alec Parker, they always had good players and they always had entertaining football at the time. And of course, pulling on the heartstrings, and my wife was saying, going back to Liverpool, you know, living in Liverpool or whatever the case may be. So I went to speak with a manager called Gordon Lee at the time. And I remember telling my father said, can I come with you? And I said, well, no, you can't come with me, but I'll pick you up afterwards and we'll go for the coffee or that. So what I wanted to find out was, is that I wanted to find out what their ambitions was, you know. And when I went to Everton, Gordon Lee said to me, he said, oh, we'll have to wait for the chairman to come in. I said, why? Does he pick the team? Does he know the tactics? Does he know? He said, oh, no, why? I said, because I want to know. That's what I want to know. I want to know where my role is, you know. Anyway, he reeled off all these players that they were selling. They were selling six players. Bob Latchford had just gone. So he was selling six players. So I said to him, well, who are you going to buy if you're getting rid of six players? Because they're first-team players. So he said, oh, we'll get you, and then we'll get a couple of Peter Eastow, who I used to play with at Wolves. And I thought to myself, he ain't got a cat in his chance. You know, I'm not, no disrespect, this is my hometown team that I supported. And I went home and I spoke to Cathy and I said to him, I don't think they've got a cat in his chance of winning things. Anyway, after that, I drove down to Birmingham and met Ron Saunders in the Metropole Hotel in the NEC. I sat down with him. I was only winning for 10 minutes. And he just said, I've got a good team, he said, but I need a final piece in the jigsaw. And he said, it's you. He said, if you sign for this club, we're going to win things. He didn't say win the championship. He said, we're going to win things. So I thought to myself, he knows what he wants. He knows. And I'd actually checked back. I'd looked at the way the team was and who was playing in the team, how he'd done the previous season. Had an awful start to the season, but ended up having a great finish to the season and ended up in the top 10.
Seventh.
Well, he ended up seventh, but he ended up losing to West Ham, I think, in the quarterfinals of the FA Cup. Yeah. So I thought to myself, yeah, they've probably got a chance then, you know. And that then is, I decided to sign. And the day I was signing for Aston Villa, I went into their lounge because he said, go and have a meal with your family. And I went into the lounge and seen all these kids walking through with all these numbered shirts on and things. I'm thinking, why are all these children coming? Well, not children, young men, really. And it was Americans. You could tell the American because they have all the, you know, the bright shirts and that. And it was Willie Bell. He come walking in, and I said to him, And he looked over at me and he said, what are you doing? I said, I'm coming to sign for Aston Villa. So he said, I said, what are you doing? And he said, I'm a preacher now. These are all my children in America. And he'd moved to America. So I said, it's just ironic that you sold me at Birmingham and I'm coming to Aston Villa to sign for Aston Villa.
So this is a dream. So you talked to Everton. They were your hometown club, the team you supported as a boy. But there was a dream you'd had, a vision you'd had of playing for Aston Villa.
Mm.
And talking about dreams come true, the real life probably exceeded the dream. To win a league championship, to play almost as an ever-present, only one or two games missed, playing with Tony Morley, with Gary Shaw, Des Bremner, Dennis Mortimer, Alan Evans, Jimmy Rimmer, Kenny Swain, all these wonderful players that came together in their sort of late 20s. This was a team of experience, of leaders, and young players with the homegrown players, Shaw and Cowans. How did it click so instantly? How did that happen? Remarkable team.
I think if you look at the two titles that are won, if you look at Nottingham Forest, of how many players we used in winning the championship, it's about a manager building a team, and not necessarily sometimes that you've got the best players in the world. You've got players who fit into their system, into the system that they play, and gets the best out of them players. Ron Saunders built this team, had a mixture. When I signed, he'd actually told me that I was going to play up front with Brian Little. When he sold the club to me, he said, you will play up front with Brian Little. He'll make goals for you and you'll make a lot of goals for them because he'll be in and around you. And unfortunately, we only played one game together and it was his testimonial for finishing his retirement. And he scored a hat-trick.
Because of his injuries.
Because of his knee injury at the time. So although Brian was there in training, he never come through. So that's where Gary Shaw was thrust into the limelight, really, and took it with both hands and grabbed it with both hands. So we had what's called, through the spine of both teams, was a very strong in the goalkeeper, in the centre half, in the centre midfield, and in the centre forward. All teams that are successful that I've been with have had that capacity.
And it was a fit team, wasn't it? I mean, one of the criticisms going around the media at the time was that Ron Saunders' training sessions were among the toughest, but you guys played for 94 minutes. You know, you were stronger in the final 15 minutes of games. And that's something that Alex Ferguson often talked about with the United, playing and playing and playing, grinding down, making sure that... he often said things like, you know, we only drew or lost that game because the referee blew the final whistle too early. Yeah. You know, this is the idea that Villa side was very fit as well, lucky with injuries.
Well, he's always renowned because he goes back to his boxing days and his army days, is that he used to do exercises that, and we used to do around about the Christmas period, that we'd do what people are doing now, we were doing what people, you know, like these planks and things like that, the fitness things that they do. We were doing things for core work, a lot of core work. And I was fit, you know, I was the fittest player at the club because I could run all day. People couldn't believe that a 6'2" man like me could run the amount of distance that I used to run. So what used to happen is that in a certain period we'd do all these exercises that basically built up the core. So when we got to the latter stages of the season, where a lot of people were flagging, we were actually getting stronger and stronger and fitter and fitter. And we could run, as you say, 95, 98, whatever the case may be. So it was in his regime. And I'm not saying that's right and that's wrong, because when we were at Nottingham Forest, we never done any training at Nottingham Forest, and yet we still was fit because he had the balance, Brian Clough had the balance of, we'd play on a Saturday sometimes and he'd say, right boys, see you Wednesday or Thursday. And we're like, what? And he'd give us 3 or 4 days off because he knew where his Ron Saunders. And when I must admit, when I came to the club and heard all the stories about his fitness regimes, when I'd done the training, I used to say to the lads, well, that ain't hard. So he said, it was hard,
yeah.
But for my mind, it wasn't as hard as what I'd been through before. And they said, oh no, he's mellowed a little bit. He doesn't do as... And he used to come, he'd come out and he'd say, right, this is what we're going to do, 45 minutes and we're finished. And he'd come out and we'd work hard for 45 minutes, finish the session. And then I'd used to do my own thing then after the trainer. So I think it's down to managers of what they want and what vision they see and how they see the players.
Incredible career he had up to that point, but even his greatest achievement may not have happened just yet. We're going to talk in part three of this remarkable achievement. Peter Withe, one of the great Aston Villa sides, winning this pot in Rotterdam. Look out for part three of the Peter Withe story on YouTube.